Okay, well then, thanks first of all for the opportunity to advertise the LOGAG reading group. But let's get into what we're here to talk about, and that is this paper called 3D Infomux Improves GNNs for Molecular Property Prediction. Yeah, and I heard that you are interested in GNNs and might also be interested in this work. And yeah, I'm going to talk a bit about this paper that came out of this collaboration with all of these awesome people, where only one person is from MIT. And yeah, well, first of all, if you have any questions, feel free to immediately interrupt me or write them in the chat or raise your hand, and I hope I will notice it. But then, yeah, let's keep going. And maybe the one sentence summary of what we're trying to do in this paper is to pre-train graph neural networks with 3D structures of molecules such that they can then make, well, better molecular property predictions. Yeah, and let's go a little bit over this thing of having GNNs operating on molecules. And what we do there is that we represent a molecule as some graph where the nodes are given by atoms, and the bonds of the molecule, like the bonds between the atoms, they are our edges in the graph. And then we can just have a GNN operating on this graph where, yeah, well, the node features can be like the atomic number or the charge or something like that. And the edge features could be, is it a single bond, a triple bond, or a double bond? Yeah, and during the presentation, I'm going to call this the 2D information. And the 3D information, what I will mean is just the individual 3D coordinates of each atom. So yeah, I'm just talking, talking about the concrete 3D coordinates, and we have different 3D coordinates that can be plausible configurations for each molecule. So let's say maybe we have this molecule in the 2D representation, and in space there are these two positions that the molecule or that the atoms could take, or that are likely for the atoms to be at. Yeah, and maybe this has the probability of occurring 60% of the time, and this has the probability of occurring 40% of the time. Like those are not just made up numbers. But to explain the principle of having different conformations, that's what we call them, for a single 2D molecule. Yeah, but what we know is if we have one of those 2D molecules, we can make pretty nice predictions on the molecular graph if we just use them as input to some graph neural network and get some representations of the whole graph. And then we use them with some MLPs to get our final property predictions. Yeah, and while this works quite well and is done a lot, we also know that we can get much better property predictions if we additionally use the 3D information as input into some 3D GNN is what I'm going to call it here, which is just some graph neural network which uses the 3D information in some smart way. Because if we were to just really use the 3D coordinates as input, you might already be able to imagine that this is not the best idea. And in case you know, some of those ones you could use are like DiamondNet, equivalent graph neural networks, or three-way message passing, but we'll get into that in more detail later as well. Okay, so we know that having 3D information helps our property predictions a lot, and having the structure of the molecule, we can get much better property predictions. But for many molecules, we actually don't know the 3D information. And this is, the 3D information is quite expensive to obtain, because it's like you can go ahead. Let's get into that later. Let me first phrase it like this. So now the situation that we're considering is the one where we have this 3D information for some molecules. So for some molecules, we have the 2D graph and we have the 3D information. But maybe exactly the molecules for which we want to predict the properties, maybe for them, we don't know the 3D information. Yeah, and then we're stuck with this approach where we just can take the 2D graph, put it through a GNN, get some node representations, pool them, and predict some properties. And yeah, if someone wants me to explain what a GNN is, for example, then also maybe just write a quick message in the chat and we'll do that. And yeah, if we do that, it's pretty fast because this GNN is just a learned architecture that has to do a single forward pass, and we get the predictions for, I don't know, depending on the size of the batch sizes you can handle, you can predict 1,000 properties for 1,000 molecules in 0.02 seconds or something like that. So it's definitely fast, but we're stuck with this 2D level of accuracy. Yeah, what are properties concretely? Let me scroll down a little bit. No, I don't have it here. Ah, okay, but properties of a molecule could be something like the highest occupied molecular orbital, like the energy of the highest occupied molecular orbital. Like this would be some quantum property of a molecule. But we can also look at properties like, does this molecule inhibit HIV replication? Or like these are maybe properties that some clinicians would care about more or want to predict more. Or another property could be, can we penetrate the blood-brain barrier? No, the brain-blood barrier. Yeah, so like this, I'm no expert there as well, but I just know that people want to predict some properties like this of molecules, and then it's nice if we can make them. Maybe a more, what will be a more concrete property, like the lipophilicity, for example. Yeah, there can be a lot of different targets or things that we might want to know about the molecule. But maybe a very concrete one is the lipophilicity of a molecule. So how poorly will it dissolve in water, in other words. Okay. And we said we are pretty bad at predicting, or we're stuck with the level of accuracy that we can get with 2D information when we're trying to predict properties from just this graph with the fast GNN. So what we could do instead is that we take our molecules for which we only know 2D information, and we use some quantum mechanical simulations to calculate the concrete 3D configuration that the atoms could take. So we can make some predictions of the, or we can calculate the 3D coordinates, the concrete ones that a molecule will take, like just from this 2D graph, if we do some physics simulations and look at what atoms we have here, what forces will there be between these atoms, or something similar to that. And yeah, then we have these quantum mechanical simulations, we end up with our good conformer of the molecule, and we can use that as an input to a 3D GNN, and we get much better property predictions. But these methods are pretty slow, and yeah, like six and a half hours per molecule slow. And yeah, in many cases, if we want to do virtual screening, for example, this would take forever. But so in a nutshell, this type of modeling helps us predict properties without going into physical experimentation. This is a question in the chat. Yeah, we can, for example, let me, the thing I just said, if we want to do virtual screening where we search through a billion molecules, this would be a concrete task, a concrete thing we could do. We are some drug discovery biologists, and now we want to find a new drug for a specific disease, which we know is caused by this bacterium that has some specific protein on its surface. And we know if if some molecule would bind to this protein, then the bacterium would no longer work, because then the actually right molecule can no longer bind to this protein. So we have this protein, and we now want to find a molecule that binds to it, because then we know that the bacterium will no longer work, and we have cured this disease. Yeah, and so we have just this protein, and we want to know if some molecule will bind to it, and maybe then a task is to, or one property that we want to predict is that that a molecule will bind to this. So the practitioner goes ahead and now uses some GNN to predict if this binding will occur for a molecule, and he does this for a billion molecules, and then our model says these 100 molecules out of your billion, they will bind to the protein, and they will cure our disease. And then we, as the drug discoverer, we of course don't trust our model, but these then are just our candidates. So the thing that the machine learning model does is just to find some probable candidates that we then actually go ahead in the lab and test if they will actually cure our disease, or I don't know, maybe something else, like be a good material, or we predicted that something has now a specific viscosity, and I need some new material that has the specific viscosity, but also the other properties that I still wanted with my material to use it as some oil. And that now my machine learning model told me this molecule will have this property, and then I go ahead and test it in the lab if that's actually the case. So in those situations, we found some probable candidates. And we, instead of testing the billion molecules in our lab experiment, which is not possible because it takes a long time, we just did this virtually with the virtual screen. Yeah, okay. And now we said we can get much better property predictions if we have this 3D information and use it as input to our 3D GNN, but we also know that it's very slow to generate, like maybe 6.5 hours per molecule. So what we do instead is we say, yeah, we have these few molecules for which we do know the 3D information. Let's just use them instead to pre-train our model. So let's use those instead to pre-train a model to then get better property predictions for molecules where we don't have 3D information. So what we do there is, right here, we have the GNN that we want to pre-train in our step one, in the pre-training step. And after we've pre-trained it to get some, to learn to reason about 3D information, we transfer its weights over here and use it to predict, or we train it, we fine tune it on the molecules for which we actually do want to make predictions. Yeah, and then after we fine tune them there, we are able to make more accurate property predictions than if we were to use no 3D information. But we also are still just as fast as the standard GNN, right? We didn't change anything about the GNN architecture or something like that. We just have better weights in the beginning that are able to produce us some implicit 3D information if this pre-training step right here works. But then let's get to this pre-training step. Like, what is it that we're actually doing there? So, okay, no. Now that I scroll to the next slide, I didn't want to talk about the actual pre-training step that we do here, but one that you might think of at the first glance, or that we should maybe also use as a baseline. Because what we could do to pre-train our GNN to get some understanding of 3D geometry just from 2D inputs, just from 2D inputs, is that we can train it to produce the 3D coordinates, right? On those molecules where we know the 3D information, there we can pre-train, or with them we can pre-train the GNN to take the 2D inputs and produce the 3D structure of the molecule. And yeah, we can do that, and we will also look at some results with that later on. But this is just our baseline. And now to do the thing that we actually do, because we have two networks here, like the one that we pre-train, and some 3D encoder that just takes the all of the 3D information and encodes it into some vector. And our 2D network during pre-training, it also just produces this vector right here. And so we have this 2D and this 3D representation here. And then we say we want the similarity between them to be high. And if the similarity is high, the idea is, well, this 2D network has to learn to encode some 3D information here, because otherwise the similarity couldn't be high to this 3D representation over here. And with similarity, we can, for example, just use something like the cosine similarity. Okay, so now if I say similarity, I really just mean the cosine similarity. Yeah, and if we were to just do that, if that's really just our single training objective, then we would have a problem, because our network over here, let's say it just produces a vector of constant twos, no matter what the input is. Like, it completely ignores the input, and the 3D network also completely ignores the input, and also just in the last layer has a bias of two and produces a vector of constant twos. Well, then we have twos here, and the similarity is maximal and the training objective is solved. But of course, we have not learned anything useful. Yeah, and to actually pre-train this in a sensible way, we can do contrastive learning, where we prevent this collapse, we call it, by not only saying that we want some high similarity, but by also saying we want low similarity with some other sample. So let's look at this example right here, where we have a batch of three molecules. Here are the 2D representations of the 3D molecule, three molecules, and here are the 3D representations of the three molecules. Yeah, and then we just produce our 2D vectors and our 3D vectors, right? And again, remember, if I say 2D and 3D, I don't mean like the dimension of the vectors. I just mean what sort of inputs they're coming from. Yeah, and then we say that the 2D representation coming from the light blue molecule, it should be very similar to the 2D representation coming from the 3D representation that belongs to the light blue molecule. Just like we did, just like we said it here. But to now prevent the collapse, we also say that it should be dissimilar to all of the other representations, to all of the other 3D representations belonging to other molecules. Yeah, and if we do that, then let's now say we are our two networks and want to solve our objective with this cheat where we just produce a constant vector of twos. Well, then we have a vector of twos here, a vector of twos here, and yeah, nice, we have a high cosine similarity, but we will also have a vector of twos here and a vector of twos here, because yeah, we're just always producing that, ignoring our input. But then we will also have a high cosine similarity instead of the low cosine similarity that we want here. So yeah, we will no longer experience this problem. And this is nicely captured in this sort of loss function, like the whole thing here, like explained here, that's nicely captured in this loss function. That's also known as info NCE. But now let's get to the thing that I said, right? I said a single molecule can have multiple plausible 3D configurations. So, and with this contrast of learning objective, we can actually really nicely capture this by just saying, yeah, we encode all of those multiple 3D representations that a single 2D molecule can have. And we say, yeah, we want to be similar to all of them. And we want to be dissimilar to all of the 3D representations that do not belong to our molecule. Yeah. And in this loss, this is really nicely or really easily achieved by just summing over all of the different conformations. So before we just did this, and now we just have the sum, and you really don't have to change a lot. Okay. But then, right, we've done everything. We have our architecture to train it. Let's test it. No, we actually don't have everything yet. Like we said, this 2D GNN is just what we want to pre-train, right? So it can be anything you want. But this 3D network, there we actually don't yet know what it should be. So let's get to that. And we want something that captures the full geometry, and we want it to be translation and rotation invariant. So what do I mean with that? Like if we take our molecule or our coordinates or 3D information and we rotate them in space, then the molecule actually stays completely the same. Or if we move them in space jointly, then the molecule just stays the same. And we want our network to see it as the same molecule, no matter how it is rotated or how it is translated. And that's what we call translation invariance and rotation invariance. Yeah, but we actually don't want it to be reflection invariant because molecules have something that's called chirality, where they differ based on their handedness. Yeah, but now Gauthier is suggesting we can achieve this, right? That we always have the same, or we always see them, or we're invariant with respect to the rotation and translation of a molecule. What we could do is to maybe have some pre-processing step. We always center them at 0, 0. Like we put the centroid of the molecule at 0, 0. And we, I don't know, how do we rotate them? Like there's no canonical way of rotating the molecule in a specific way, such that it's always take an arbitrary rotation. Is that what you mean?
Yes, so I can talk maybe to you. So I may have said something stupid because I don't know much about this field, but I would take, like, for example, maybe a given one, okay? A given molecule, and then I guess maybe some atoms, you can like tag them or reference. Then you take another one, you try, okay, this atom matches to this one to this one, so you can maximize try to search for the rotation that maximizes the alignment of the matching atoms, and then you see if it matches perfectly or not. Or
so you're saying we have one molecule, like an arbitrary molecule,
and so maybe not one, but one per so some will be totally different, some have a chance to be actually the same, but translation and rotation invariant. So you take, you have a first criterion that say, okay, those they can be like roughly similar because they have, I don't know, same atoms and whatever. So you took one of the group as the representative, and then you try to find the rotation that aligns it the best. So if they are the same, but you will be able to find this rotation. If they are not, but you will find a rotation that aligns them a bit, but not fully.
Yeah. So we have a group of molecules that we see as the representative orientation, so to say. And each new molecule that we're looking at, we just align it as good as possible to all of them, and then take the position that is the best aligned to one of those molecules. And that's what we use as the input to our GNN, right?
Yeah, that would be a naive thought from me, but probably it's not working. But that would try without if I didn't have like a equivariant or whatever GNN at end.
Yeah. So with that, we would definitely already be better than if we were to just use the 3D coordinates straight away. But we still have the issue that, well, first of all, we have to know how many molecules do we actually choose to do that. And we also are still like not able to, we don't have this generalization guarantee. Like if we are really invariant, then we're guaranteed to generalize to, like we're guaranteed to completely ignore the orientation of the molecule. Yeah, and now one idea how we can do that instead of the idea that Gautier proposed is, for example, we could just use all of the pairwise distances. Right, and this way, if we just look at all of the pairwise distances, then those distances, they won't change if we move the molecule in space or if we rotate it. The distances all stay the same. But maybe another idea, remember with this, we have some quadratic complexity because we have to use the distances from each node to each other node. But actually, that's not so bad for molecules where we only have a few atoms. But another thing that we could do, where do I have it? Is just to look at, to use a GNN with some distance, where we look at the distances and some angles between the different bonds. And this way we can also completely specify the 3D geometry. Yeah, and now let's maybe look at some results that we're getting, that we can get with this. So what we're doing here is we're predicting the properties of this data set, which is called QM9. So there we have these 8 properties of some quantum mechanical properties. And right here in this column, you see the mean average error that we're getting when we're trying to predict the property with a GNN that is randomly initialized. Meanwhile, in these columns, you see the mean average errors. So lower values here are better if we are predicting the properties with the same GNN, but pre-trained with our method. And we used either QM9, like a disjoint half of QM9 for pre-training here, or the Geom Dirac data set, where we also just have a few molecules and 3D positions, or the QMAX data set for pre-training. And yeah, we can see that we're getting quite a bit better numbers than if we just use the randomly initialized model. And here you can see the numbers that we would get if we really had the true ground truth 3D information. So yeah, of course we can't reach that, but we can try to get as close as possible to this, right? Our implicit 3D information won't be as good as the true 3D information, but we still are hoping to get as close as possible to this. And yeah, we're definitely not, for some properties, we're definitely very far away, and it's really necessary to have the true ground truth 3D information that is expensive to calculate. But we definitely also are better than the randomly initialized model, and we can get some gains with this implicitly generated 3D information. Then let's maybe get to this, right? I said we could instead just use this pre-training method where we predict some 3D coordinates instead of doing our complicated mutual information maximization pre-training thing. So, and that's what we're doing in these two rows right here. There we're generating just some 3D coordinates, and here we're using our pre-training method. And we can also just see that the improvements that we're getting with our pre-training method is just always higher than with this baseline. But I guess that's maybe expected. And then this is basically the same again as the table two pages ago. Before we get into that, we have the question: is 3D information the best and exhaustive information we can have on these molecules, or is there an even better representation for the molecules? Well, the best information for what? The best information for predicting, say, the conformational energy of the molecule. The best information we could have there is some information about the conformational energy of the molecule. So, like the best representation of molecules. We could maybe say there are representations like smiles, or where we just have a string representing a molecule, or a representation of as graph. But these two are actually exactly the same. Like, you can translate from the string representation to the graph representation and back without losing any information. And now the 3D information is just something that we know is valuable to know to make predictions. And I guess in that sense, it could be the best information. But you can also look at something like you could also look at some densities or some density fields of the electrons around the molecule, and then you would have much more information. Or you could look at the wave function. Like, if you have the wave function of a molecule, then you really have information about exactly all of these properties. So yeah, those representations are in some sense better because they exactly tell you this, all of this information. But in what sense is a representation? I mean, what's the best representation of a molecule to tell me the ZPVE of the molecule? Well, maybe the ZPVE value of the molecule. So yeah, that's maybe isn't the most insightful what I'm saying. But best.
No, I think it's from the high level understanding I can have, it's like really task specific. And yes, we can enrich the info on 3D, but in some cases it will help and some not. And it depends on what you want to try to predict, right?
Yeah.
So 3D is not the end goal representation for representing molecules. Sometimes you want to use another representation of them for doing something else.
But we, like, if we're saying what's the ultimate representation of a molecule, then we can also just look at the 2D graph, because the 2D graph in theory just contains all of the 3D information as well. Like, you can go ahead and do some quantum simulations and calculate the 3D information from the 2D graph. But to have it explicitly is just much more valuable. But what you're saying is absolutely correct, that for some tasks, the 3D information helps, and for some it doesn't. And for that, let's look at this table right here, where we have these different data sets, where we have some different tasks for molecules. And yeah, we have these mean or these performances that we can get with our 3D Informax, where we use the implicit 3D information. And we see that for properties like these down here, like for ClinTox, for example, we're predicting whether the outcome of some clinical trials, like the toxicity outcomes. For HIV, we are predicting the ability to inhibit HIV replication. Yeah, and you can see that there, we're not really getting any improvements over the randomly initialized model. And this is maybe somewhat expected that for these tasks, the 3D information is maybe not so helpful, like to predict the outcome of some clinical trials. Maybe this is just a clinical trial where the 3D information wasn't helpful. But for properties like the solubility or the lipophilicity, where we know that this depends on some intrinsic properties of the molecule and not like the HIV replication inhibition, where it depends on how some molecules interact that we don't even have access to. Yeah, for those ones that depend on intrinsic properties, there we can see that the 3D Informatics pre-training definitely helps, and we're reducing the root mean squared error, right? Remember here, the lower values are better in these rows. Okay, so, yeah, so exactly what Gauthier was saying. By the way, later you have to tell me how to pronounce your name. I'm pretty sure that I'm not getting it exactly. But then let me conclude. We have now some pretty nice improvements with this method of the randomly initialized baseline, and the representations that we're getting, they generalize well. But what we can do in the future is maybe to combine this 3D pre-training method that we cooked up with some normal pre-training methods. And I suppose Gauthier is correct. And my pronunciation of the name. And what would also be interesting is to use this for larger molecules, like for proteins maybe. And maybe to do some protein binding predictions, where we somehow include the 3D information of the protein and of the molecule. Because for protein binding, we know that the 3D structure is super, super important, because the molecule kind of has to fit into the binding pocket of the protein. Yeah. And then we also have this thing of encoding 2D information. We also remember, right, we're doing this mutual information maximization thing, where I said we want to train the 2D network to encode 3D information here, because otherwise the mutual information couldn't be high. But what if the 3D network just learns to encode 2D information? Then, yeah, we don't really force the GNN, the 2D net here, to encode 3D information, because the mutual information could just be maximized by 2D stuff that is encoded here and here. So it would be nice to somehow prevent this 3D network from encoding 2D information here. And maybe we can improve the performance even more of that. Yeah, and now that you know how this method works, feel free to check it out as the paper. Let's scroll up to the name of the paper. Or you can also just search this online, and you will probably find my name somewhere. Or go on my website and check out the GitHub, where you have the code for everything. And you can maybe, I don't know, if you are in this field, generate some molecular fingerprints or something like that.